Welcome to Breakfast with Mr. Saturday Night. We're here in my living room with our friend Douglas Sherman, who we know from The Loft and Joy Party. Mm-hmm. But I'm going to stop there with my introduction because I think it'd be good for you to introduce yourself and describe your relationship to those parties and how you're involved, because I know it's a really important topic for you. So you wanna tell us all about it?
Well, I guess that's, you know, as in terms of a starting point, it's always kind of interesting when people want to introduce me as a DJ, and I kind of shy away from that because I don't consider myself necessarily to be a DJ in terms of how I define it. And I think of myself more as somewhere between a librarian and a musical selector, somewhere more in that realm. And I think it's because I don't mix. I really don't mess around with the music itself, other than to calibrate the system as best I can so that the music can be heard the way the artist intended. And I think that kind of goes in large part to the heart of what I've learned in terms of my involvement with The Loft, and it's what resonates in terms of over the years with the parties.
Well, I mean, you say you're not a DJ in terms of you don't mix records, but you certainly build a mood and read a room,
right,
and select the next record to play,
right,
according to what you see in front of you. And that to me is a way more important skill than the technical skill of mixing records. Is that something you feel that you do when you play at the parties?
Yeah, I mean, it's the idea of trying to create a tapestry of music. So there are kind of think of it in three parts. First part being the calm. And that's the very beginning of the party. And so the energy levels, people just arriving, we may still be setting up and different things kind of going on in anticipation of the party just kind of getting started. So there's kind of the calm. And then there's that transition that goes into the next part, which would be circus. And circus is really like, you know, where you have a lot of the peaks and all of that with the energy of the music. And then you have the third part, which would be what is considered the re-entry. And that's kind of bring people down and home. And I think always it comes back to this idea of being kind of home and being able to play music for your friends and music that they like to hear and just creating an environment that is kind of collective, a collective spirit. It's everything. It's not just what is happening in terms of the music selection. There's the food, there's the vibe that people bring, there's what they bring in terms of their own contributions to the party. And so I think in terms of a more holistic approach, it's really creating an experience that you kind of, first of all, you don't want it to end, and then at the same time, you can't wait to have it again. So it's really creating this kind of experience that just, you know, resonates with everyone in the room. So it's never about one person, because when you get that to that point, then I think it becomes something else, and it's not a kind of a pleasurable experience that I seek out. So
it's harder to share, I think, when it's harder to share with all the people around you as an attendee when it's just about that person over there, for example, right? Like, I feel like there's this idea of the show that I think has infiltrated the music industry, not just in the DJ world, but in the band, in the live music world as well, where most bands that I hear, most bands that I listen to, their music doesn't make sense on a stage. Their music doesn't make sense to go and you walk into the venue, you stand and you watch it on the stage, and like 9 times out of 10, something doesn't feel right because all the attention is aimed at these people who are doing a thing that largely is not a show. You know, you think of like the whole shoegaze movement in the 90s, the whole point was them kind of being like, you know, we're not here to be looked at. We're just going to stand and look at our shoes while we play this music. Yet all those bands, when they perform, they were performing on a stage, and it didn't really make any sense. And so that has, as the world of DJs has grown more popular, that's that same idea that I think has kind of messed with live music starts to mess with the experience of clubs, where the DJ is put onto this pedestal.
When it's supposed to be a shared experience,
right,
amongst all the attendees that are there. And I think that's what you were talking about.
Right, yeah.
Yeah, and just to go back to the introduction that you graciously were making. Yeah, I try to avoid this type of association in the sense that, you know, I'm not the spokesperson for the Loft or anything like that. I'm a part of assisting with the parties. David Mancuso, who I've known for 35 years now, and as a friend, as a brother, as a father figure in some ways, and as a family member, he's just a member of my family and of a larger family of my in-laws. And, you know, I think I've gained his trust, and I'm just grateful that he's allowed me to be a part of the parties to the extent that I am.
Because you're the guy that's playing the records at those parties. Do you feel like you're taking over from David?
No, there's no taking over.
Not taking over, and I'm not talking like a power move, like muscle.
No, there's no taking over because
like you're carrying forward the legacy.
Think of it like that, because think of it, the role that I play is no different than an amplifier. If you set up your amplifier, and you have your left channel and your right channel, and your left channel goes out, do you have a backup plan for that? Mm-hmm. What are you prepared to do? Because you're already in flight. The room is full.
Right.
And you're just going to play with, you know, so what have you done in preparation or in anticipation of having a backup plan? Because in the end, you're only as good as your backup plan. So for me, in that role, if something happens, you know, I talked about my back causing me problems. If there's a night where or leading up to a party where I can't stand, I can't fulfill my responsibility, what's the backup? Then there has to be someone else. And David will always have he'll be prepared with a backup plan. So it's never this idea
that
I'm taking
over,
because somebody else always has to be ready. And it should be somebody that, first of all, he could trust, because you're playing with high-end equipment, and you can't get into all the kind of the egotistical things that go with that. So when people come over and they see you in that role, it's very easy to kind of be seduced by it. And you always have to remain focused. You're dealing with, you know, the Quetzu cartridges, which are, you know, relatively expensive cartridges. You know, they're not meant to be cued or backtracked or anything like that. And you just have to be on point with what you're doing. And while the party's swirling around you, you're kind of you're dealing with all those things at the same time. So, you know, essentially, you want somebody that you trust. It's like you're allowing somebody to come into your home and put records on your equipment. You have a pretty
I'm nice putting the records here. On just for the record.
There you go.
I'm the only one.
And so for you to allow someone else to do it, it would have to be a point where you gain a lot of trust.
Right. I hope to one day gain your trust.
Yeah,
that's right. We all do. We're getting there
slowly.
So I think just because we will keep talking, but we should play some music.
We'll play a record.
I'm curious to hear. Did you bring anything with you that would fit into the coming home category?
Mm-hmm.
You did.
Mm-hmm.
You want to pull?
I kind of brought little examples of everything, but. You're talking about like the reentry piece.
I
think we both like locked in when he said that, because that's a really interesting description you gave that part of the party, which, you know, I feel like that resonated with me because I think that happens at our party, not always.
Yeah.
But there's that point in time when you've got a dance floor to a point where you just know you can take them in a real left turn with something that isn't necessarily like a dance floor track, and they'll go with you because you've got them at that point.
Right, yeah.
So I guess taking them home is...
45. I just got this copy too.
Can I see?
There's no cover on it. It's just a generic sleeve. But this would be a good example of, you know, as you're bringing the energy down and kind of preparing people for, you know, a gracious exit.
Right. What's the record called?
It's the Gap Band, and it's called Outstanding.
Oh, yeah. Of course. Yeah.
And, you know, certain records become signature records, as you know, that... When you hear that, you're like, oh man, that's getting ready to wind it down now, you know? Huh. So now your head starts going, if you've been a regular attendee of the parties.
Right.
But for someone that may be coming for the first time and doesn't have any reference for anything, it's just the energy that,
right,
you know, and it's just one of those records that, you know, you just groove to it.
Yeah. It's the idea of signature records. That's something that I've noticed from going to both Joy and the Loft and other parties that I love, is that there will be like themes almost of the party. And I think about that a lot when I'm pulling records, and I'm often conflicted, you know, because we play every single week.
We'll have to get you therapy.
Right, yeah. Thank you. I appreciate it. Well, hopefully we can talk it out now, right? You can make me feel better about it. But I'm conflicted about playing a song too much, playing songs so that people get tired of them. And on the other side, playing songs and letting them become signature songs of the party. And I mean, how do you think about that when you're packing records?
I think I'm conflicted as well. Like there was a Herb Albert edit that I've been playing, like probably too much, right? This year, and then I decided that was it. I was gonna put it away.
Yeah.
And then we had a party, and you know, feeling at the dance floor, trying to really make it work, and I'm seeing some new faces that haven't come through yet in that part in the summer. And I went for it because I knew it was the right tool to play at that time to like bring the party together,
right.
and people really responded to it. So it felt good to play it at that point in time, but now I've since stopped playing it because, well, for the same reason that you're conflicted, it's like, because we try to push new music as well. We get the label and new music in the way we play, and we're also interested in new music, of course. So it's striking that balance between playing something new, playing something old, and also like having that anthem thing where you're playing it all the time and people just really respond every time.
Right, like, oh yeah, playing this song again, you
right.
know? Yeah.
But I think that conflict's probably a good thing because it makes you do all of those things.
Okay.
And try and strike a balance.
That makes me feel better.
Yeah.
Well, you know, one...
fine. I'll tell you. I'll let you know.
A record that kind of illustrates that point was when Set It Off came out by Strafe.
Right.
David had gotten like an advanced copy of it, and I think Walter Gibbons did that record. And so he had an advanced copy and he put it on and it cleared the floor.
Oh, well, that was a pretty unusual sign of record.
So that was the first time.
Yeah.
Then, and we were doing parties every Saturday at this time. So then the next week, put it on again, cleared the floor. Everybody just walked off the floor, and I was like, and I knew it was a good record. I mean, I felt it was a good record. But it cleared the floor. Then the third party, David put it on again. And now people are like, oh, that's that record. And you know how it starts? It's like a call to the floor.
Yeah.
And the opposite happened.
Huh.
So it's really, you know, sometimes you just have to be persistent.
Right.
But Set It Off was one of those records. And then it became like, I wouldn't say necessarily an anthem, but certainly a record that people wanted to hear every party.
Oh, yeah.
Did, in the meantime, in those 3 weeks, did it like start to hit the radio or something like that?
No.
It was out.
It was, you know, being distributed right. among DJs.
So there's a good chance that those people had been going out to other places, that they'd heard it in other places.
It's
in
hard
the
to say. All I can tell you is, when that record starts, it's just one of those things where suddenly it just clicked.
Right.
And now everybody's like putting down if they had a beer or whatever they're holding or talking. Say, excuse me, I gotta go dance.
Right.
And that was one of those records that became like that.
Right.
Another record that was kind of broken in, but a little differently, was by Larry Levan. And there's a story where there's Heartbreak.
Heartbeat.
And he was a little more aggressive about it.
We'd play like seven
David
times.
David is very
night,
gentle
like
when
right?
it comes to how he would introduce a record. He'll play it once and then he'll move on.
Right.
But Larry was a little more persistent with his parties in terms of like new music he would break in. I know with Danny Krivit, in conversations with him, part of his approach is, you know, give the people what they want. And then you can kind of be experimental,
right?
Yeah,
with what you personally think is interesting,
right? Yeah.
So I think everybody kind of finds some conduit to kind of reach the dancer, because ultimately that's what you want. I'm always thinking people in the lounge area, in the kitchen area, you want to kind of get them to migrate onto the dance floor, and you want everybody ultimately to be dancing on the mirror ball. To me, that's like,
well, and so what is your philosophy behind it? Do you think of it in the way that Danny thinks of it?
No,
because I hear, I ask this specifically because I hear a lot of the same records at the Loft as when David used to play. And I wonder if that's just because you love those records, or if because you feel like you have a responsibility to continue a tradition in a sort of way, that like there are certain records that need to be played when it's a Loft party. Right?
It's a little of both.
Yeah.
It's a little of both. But I think one thing with, just generally speaking, this is not necessarily, you know, the Loft being one thing. In terms of just my approach to music, is it's always just finding music that's interesting. And it may be unfamiliar to people, but I think if it's a really interesting piece, you play it, and every record to me is like a book. It has a story to tell, and it releases some degree of energy into the room, and whatever is going to happen, it's going to happen. And sometimes it clicks, sometimes it may not, and that's just part of the flow. But you know, you're going through a whole night of music, so.
If you find something's not clicking, do you, obviously I'm kind of generalizing when I ask you this question, because I know from my own experience that there's not like a way that it goes. But to generalize here, if you find that a record's not working, are you more inclined to go for, when you're playing at the Loft, for example, a Loft classic? Are you like, okay, this is a little weird, I can tell that people are not really into this, I'm gonna go for something that like everybody, or like 75%
of
people are gonna know.
Well, it's not so much thinking of it as a Loft classic, it's just thinking of it of something that is maybe more familiar to people, but also will definitely inspire, you know, a moment of dancing.
But if you ever like take that chance and play something that's new or interesting, and you see perhaps that people aren't responding to it,
then it goes under the Christmas tree.
Oh, really?
It does? Pretty much, yeah.
Really?
Yeah. So that's where we used to have a Christmas tree. And at certain time, at Christmas time, we just put records all underneath the tree, and people would come. And
oh, okay.
Sometimes people would scoop up armfuls of records, and we'd say, you know,
do you never be like, okay, I'm gonna, maybe that I played it at the wrong time, or people, or like Larry Levan, they just don't understand it yet. I got to play it to them a few more times.
That's your judgment call,
right? Well, that's what I'm interested in, right? Yeah. Because I have those moments where I'll buy a record, I'll play it, and I won't get the response that I need. And my relationship to that record changes, and I'll put it away, and I won't play it again. And then I'll find myself coming back to my comfort zone in the stuff that I know works. And then I've had instances where down the line I've heard another DJ play the record that I've rejected, and I've been like, that's amazing, or the context has been different and it's really worked, and I'm like, damn, I didn't have the confidence to like keep going with that record myself. Yeah. And I'll go back and dig it out and I'll play it and it'll work. And then I'll be like, right. I guess that's kind of the learning curve you're going through your head where you got to understand why it didn't work in that point in time and hold it back as a tool to be used at the right time.
You know what I've started to do in the past couple of years with one of the main points of fixing that for myself is if I buy a record and like I bought it, so I obviously thought it was good on some level and I bring it to a party and it doesn't work for whatever reason, I'll put it back in the crates that are on my DJ setup in my studio. And when I'm doing my practice mixes, I will pull it out and make myself mix it in. I'm gonna try to find the right place to mix it in. Yeah. And I'm always making myself these like 1 hour long mixes so that I can just like listen to records and get familiar with them. Mm-hmm. But I found that by doing that, I become familiar enough with the record. And a lot of times I find a contact for that record to work in. Mm-hmm.
Do you have a sound? Do you like, is there something you use as a type of soundboard for something new?
You mean when you say soundboard?
You put a record on and you have a daughter now?
I have a daughter now, yeah.
Is she like, does she respond to some of the records you play?
She responds.
So she loves put the on a record. Techno.
See, like my daughter, there was a record and it was her favorite record and it kind of, not necessarily a signature record, but it was a popular record for a lot of the parties. And that was Ping Pong by, it's a pink label. I forget the name. Uh-huh. The name of it is Ping Pong.
Okay.
And
is it a newish?
No. Okay. Well, from the 80s.
Okay.
Maybe 90s. The 90s. And every time I put that record, and she may have been around four at the time, but I would put that record on and that got her going. You know, that was one of those records. So sometimes, and it doesn't necessarily mean just anything that maybe sometimes becomes, you know, I'll give you another example. When I was designing the t-shirt, I had different variations of it. And so it was suggested that rather than say, what do you think this, you know, it was suggested just, I have a piano in my home and I laid them all out on top of the piano and I didn't say anything. And I waited for my daughter to come down. It was early in the morning. She comes down and she kind of glances over and she sees them. There's like four or five variations of this design. She kind of looks over and she goes in the kitchen. And so I said, did you see? And she says, yeah, it looked kind of cool. I said, any one of them kind of stand out to you? And she goes back over and, yeah, this one, I like that one. And that was it. So there's this kind of organic process that takes place without trying to influence it yourself. And so I think sometimes you need that kind of, maybe something other than, you know, when you are kind of going through it in your head.
Other than yourself.
Yeah. Not necessarily always during a party.
For my wife, you know? And I feel like, especially, there are certain records that I just know, like, it's her kind of thing, and, like, it's easy. But if I can play, like, what I would consider, like, a deeper record or a trackier record, but she likes it, I know I've got a good record.
Right.
Okay. Right?
Because there's probably something, like...
There's something that elevates it.
There's a groove in there or a particular sign that
she's like,
sets it apart.
And, you know, I'm putting records all the time at home. And what's nice is when you don't have to be like, what do you think about this record? But she'll be like, what is this? Right? And then you're like, oh, this is a good one. Right? Mm-hmm. Like, if she's asking what it is, it's good.
Mm-hmm. So,
just because I feel like we should keep listening to music as we're talking here. This is, play part two. So this is a record... For me, that is kind of like the opposite of what we were just talking about. It's a record that I haven't played at the party in years, but it's because it holds this special moment for me. There, I played it. We did our 100th party in 2012. I think it's 45, Eamon.
Yep.
You got it, 45?
Yep.
So I played it at the 100th party that we did, and I don't think I've played it again since then, and that's because it's
so Vince Montana.
This is Touch of Class.
Oh, Touch of, that sounds like Vince Montana.
It does, doesn't it?
It may be.
Well, he was, you know, they're all MFSB did like all the music for like some of the best, you know, OJs and all of them. It's all
I mean, the production
stylistics.
Like it.
Blue Magic, all the musicians on those records, it's all MFSB guys.
Right.
And so that definitely sounds like...
the whole production sounds like...
MFSB.
Right.
Because yeah. They're all studio musicians.
Yeah.
They were tremendous, man, those guys.
Yeah.
But, yeah, so what I was saying is that...
Touch of class.
This record is one where I played it and, like, I don't feel like... I'm sure one day again I'll pull it out.
This is a taking them home record, for sure.
Definitely a taking them home record.
Yeah.
And it was just this magic moment in the party for me playing it. I felt like I mixed that out of the track that came before it well.
Is it on the recording?
Yeah, it's on the recording.
Right.
It's on the recording. But it's just the flip of what we're talking about, of like having a record where you're like, this doesn't really work. It's like, this record works so well that I feel like I just need to let it be that thing that happened that time.
You see, and then what it comes back to for me is that every record should stand on its own.
Right.
And that's probably one of the biggest lessons, if I want to call it a lesson, that I could take away from my relationship with David, is that every record should stand on its own. So if you really have something good,
just let it
you
know play. What?
Yeah, you let it play, man.
Right.
He even did one party where he decided that particular night, I'm not going to select any records. I'm going to let all the guests select the records. So people were calling out records or walking up and so it became like a progression that he would never necessarily follow, but it worked. And people
Was there like a list?
People no list. People just knew what they just, if they knew Touch of Class, they would play that Touch of Class record, man.
Right.
Yep.
Right.
And then somebody might say, hey, you got that Crown Heights Affair record. And that's how the party, the whole night was like that.
Right. Did he announce that it was going to be this way? Or he just let that
I don't
happen?
Know how it just kind of came about. And, you know, everybody in the room just kind of picked up on it.
I did this party.
Classic disco, man, yeah.
And actually, there's a 12-inch version of this song, and there's the 45 version. So this is part two on the 45 version, which has got the instrumental intro. Mm-hmm. And I have a 12-inch, and I never play the 12-inch. This is the version that I really like, because it gets
B-side.
In that groove first, and the vocals open up at the end.
Before the birth of the 12-inch, it was always the B-sides, all the DJs. You know, we went from a jukebox to either you had a live band or a jukebox, but then suddenly you had these DJs, you know, beat matching or trying to, and it was all 45s, and most of the records that the dance floor, dancers were responding to were the B-sides.
Huh.
Right.
Yeah. There you go.
Yeah. I think Danny does like a whole 45 on his party,
right?
He's
been DJing for 45 years.
He has like a pretty major collection.
I went to his... The party he did celebrate in 45 years, where he just played 45s. Mm-hmm. He did like a 6-hour set of playing 45s, and he had a setup.
He played like 3,000 records.
He probably had about at least 6,000 45s all sitting around. Me had a bunch of guys just feeding them through, and he was playing on the ENS, and it was killer.
The best way to have done that would have been to have the old automatic turntables,
right,
where you put a stack on it like this, and each record drops one at a time.
Right.
And that's how we used to do it at home. You just put the stack
then
on.
Then he wouldn't have been able to mix, which I know.
Oh, yeah, that's right. That's true. That's true. Yeah, we're back to that.
Yeah,
right.
Back to that. You got a record, Amy?
Yep.
I do have with many
nice
records.
Nice choice, by the way.
Thanks.
Yeah. I'm going to play... a record by Milton Wright. Do you know Milton Wright? This is one of my favorite soul records. I don't know an awful lot about him, apart from the fact that he's now a judge. And I don't think he was ever a full-time musician. I think he recorded a few albums whilst he was like probably being a lawyer or a judge of some sort. Yeah, it's just a really beautiful record that I've played a bunch of time at the parties, at various points. I've used it to like close the party out. I've used it at the very end of the party in the sort of coming home phase, and also also to open the party up. And the track I'm going to play is called "Friends and Buddies."
Which is
really, really nice.
The label that put this out is this label called the label that reissued this. It's called Athens of the North. Have you heard of them?
Athens?
Athens of the North?
No.
Man, they do so many good reissues, mostly on 45. But I have this.
And the name of this track is?
Friends and Buddies.
Friends and Buddies.
Yeah.
Nice.
You know this Leroy Hudson record? You've heard me play. I've played at the party a couple times now. But they did this reissue of it. Leroy Hudson was the guy who, he replaced Curtis Mayfield in the Impressions when Curtis went on to do his solo career. And I think that this came out on Kurtom, Curtis's label.
Right.
Know? I mean, it certainly looks like it. But Athens of the North, you know, when they do a reissue, they make it look like the original
really?
Label. Yeah, but they do it with their own AOT logo.
Okay.
But man, so many good records on this label.
How do you discover new music? Where do you go like physically? Where do you go virtually to like find new stuff?
You know, sometimes I just stumble across things. Sometimes, I call it doing homework. So I'll come across an artist and I'll look at the label. If I like a particular record, I'll go through their catalog. I'll look at the label. I'll look at who produced it, and I'll see what else they kind of, where that kind of leads me. So I'm always.
Are you using Discogs to follow things like this?
Discogs is one source.
Yeah.
Sometimes it's, I could be YouTube, Discogs. Sometimes I'll Shazam something, and the wrong record it'll tag a different record.
Right.
But you know what? That record actually is pretty good too. And then I'll see where that goes. So it you know, there's no real pattern,
right,
necessarily, other than just having the time to kind of dig. And then sometimes just going down to like A1 Records.
Right.
And you know, sometimes people will be really gracious enough to come over and, hey Doug, you might be interested in this, you know, and,
right,
or I'll come across something and I'll say, you know, that's a familiar label, but I don't know that track. And
when you go into A1, where do you go first? Which section?
Well, it there really isn't, because it depends. If somebody's in an area that I would typically look in, then I'll go, you know, so it depends.
Yeah.
So they have their classic section where they'll put the newer stuff that just came in, and I'll dig through there. And then there's more the deep house section of newer stuff that just came in.
Right.
So it all depends where, if somebody's already kind of digging through that category.
But would you say that you are typically looking in the house and disco sections mostly?
No, I look at everything. I go through everything.
Yeah.
Sometimes I'll go to the soundtrack section and I'll see what I find in soundtracks.
Right.
There's a compilation section and I pulled out stuff from there that were like little golden nuggets, man, that I didn't expect to find.
Mm.
So it really, there's no, you know, I'll go into the African section and I found a Sunny A Day record that was just simply beautiful, that I wasn't familiar with. And it was kind of in the realm of 365 is my number. It's kind of like that, kind of just beautiful music, you know. So
you know, you and I have talked about this a little bit, just hearing you talk about going across all the different sections. There's, because Justin and I think we play lots of different types of music, and although the core of the parties, you know, is dance music, we're interested in all sorts of types of music. We play all sorts of types of music and we buy all sorts of types of music. But I think then what the flip side is that is you don't go super, super deep in any particular one direction. It's just time, you know, and energy. Like if you go into a record store and you want to like, you know, you want to go to like the experimental avant-garde section and you also want to just go in and dig in the classics and everywhere in between, like, there's only so many hours in the day,
only so much energy that you have to absorb information too, right?
So it's this sort of conflict between, again, it's another conflict between, you know, do you just spend the next 12 months getting into, like, you know, spiritual jazz, or do you continue to buy music and access music in the way that you've always done?
I mean, I know that. For a while, I was like really getting deep into the blues and like reading books about the blues and buying a lot of blues records. But it's funny, like, I'll still buy blues records now, but I'm not focused on it as much. But I find, and it's probably just my personality, and I like to think of it as a good part of my personality, is not feeling like I know enough, that I always need to learn more. But when I think about my blues records, I still feel like I don't know enough even about the records that I have.
Right.
And again, it's a time thing, right?
Mm-hmm.
But what I like to tell myself is that, you know, I've picked up some knowledge, and that along the way of, you know, my time reading about the blues and listening to blues, that I learned something about, like, the beginning of modern music, mm-hmm. the beginning of recorded music in a way, mm-hmm. that informs, just that helped me learn about other types of music. But I do have this, like, admiration for the guys that, like, they just know all the Northern Soul records, right? Like,
right.
They just know everything about Northern Soul, or about disco, or about blues, or whatever it is.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
There are these, in my digging around in the world of blues, I read the Amanda Petrich's book called Do Not Sell at Any Price, which is about these, like, intense 78 collectors who are going to try to find, like, the only remaining copy of
the Holy Grail records.
Yeah, yeah. But, like, Holy Grail, like, beyond what the three of us are looking for.
Yeah.
I say beyond what the three of us are looking for. I'm sure that we each own records that are probably pretty rare and not that many copies of. But I think somehow that these are, like, these guys are beyond that, because they're collecting records that are really, really rare, and they're also, at this point, like 100 years old.
Right. But, you know, you have to make a distinction between being a collector and playing records.
Yeah.
Right.
And to me, there could be some overlap, but generally, I don't consider myself a collector of records, because then it's you're inclined not to necessarily play them too often.
Right.
You know, as opposed to just having a record to add to your musical library,
yeah. right.
that's meant to be played.
Or you may not even be a huge fan of the music, because there's a whole like collector thing that's just, I don't really
like a completist thing where like you gotta have all the stuff.
It's more the acquisition than anything
else.
Or guys who have like 20 copies of each Led Zeppelin record. Like every time they see Led Zeppelin 3, they buy Led Zeppelin 3.
Right.
They have like,
although there is a rare release of Led Zeppelin 3, the one with, or 2, I think it's the second album, and actually split it into 4 records, I think.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Right.
So they're almost like 12 inches of like Moby Dick and
oh, wow.
Whole Lot of Love, and yeah, that one.
Have you got it?
I would buy a second copy.
It's on
copy.
This, you could see it on this guy.
Yeah,
you know, one of the things I
do
is a lot of money. Yeah, that's a lot
right.
of money. I probably hundreds. Won't stop Justin.
It's hundreds.
No,
it's gonna be like
$400
or $500 record, easy. And so that's a bit out of my price league. And, you know, I've gotten to the point where I'm like, you know, sometimes the U.S. pressing is just fine.
Right.
You know, and especially today, one of the things I kind of discovered is with a lot of the reissues, it really is buyer beware, because they're not using the original master to press them. And a lot of them are, you know, digital remasters, and they don't quite hit the quality. And sometimes you're better off.
Or the depth. Right?
Like with the detail, the nuance. It's sometimes you're better off maybe with getting maybe a slightly worn original copy than a repress.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You know, so so sometimes just the original.
You know what I had for a while? I'm like guilty of having spent too much money on a record in this case. That Gloria Ann Taylor record, Love is a Hurting Thing. It's a brilliant record.
Yeah,
it's a really, really brilliant record.
I have more homework to do, I guess.
We all do, right?
That's the thing. There's just so much music
out
there. There really is. I mean, you mentioned like how do you, you know, one of my coworkers is a West Point graduate, and we talk sometimes about music. He's in the tech division at my job, and he loves bagpipes. And that's kind of a tough thing to kind of, for you know, musically to get into. You know, it has its place for me, but he was talking about an album that came out. And I just can't think of the artist's name, musician's name. It's called Bagpipe Blues.
Mm-hmm.
And he's originally a saxophone player with no training on the bagpipes, but he picked it up and played it like a saxophone.
Huh.
And he did tracks, you know, selections that are familiar, but on a bagpipe. It's called Bagpipe Blues from 1968.
Do you have it?
I don't have it.
Where was he from? Was he American? The artist?
Yeah,
he was American?
Yeah, he's an American jazz artist. Right. Oh, his name escapes me at the moment. But
wow.
Yeah, Bagpipe Blues.
You don't have it in your bag?
No, I didn't bring it. Yeah, it piques your interest, right?
Yeah.
We started talking
about
bagpipes, and you know, and he's into, because coming out of the West Point, of course, he had to share with me like the history of it, going through all the different periods. And in one thing I didn't know, that in a court of law was actually declared an instrument of war.
The bagpipe?
Yes.
Wow.
What, here in the States?
Not here, I think in England.
Right, okay.
I can think of many instances where that's appropriate.
Yeah.
Do you want to stick another record on?
Sure.
While you're digging, I just complete my thought on the Gloria Ann Taylor record and talking about pressings and reissues. So I had the original pressing of that, there was a reissue, and
didn't the reissue come out literally like a week after you bought the original?
It came out not too long after I bought the original, and when I bought the reissue and I A-B'd them, and there was a difference for sure, but the reissue was done with enough, it was done in a quality way. Mm-hmm. I sold my original copy of it, because what is it about? It's about how does it sound?
It's like having a good sounding copy on vinyl.
Right, exactly, exactly.
Right,
so.
Yeah.
Well, you know, here's one that I just kind of picked up as an import. This, you know, we mentioned soundtracks, and sometimes soundtracks can produce music that just outlasts the movie itself. But mm-hmm. in this case, this was one where the movie was really good and the soundtrack was really good. And Norman Whitfield, who's a great producer from the Motown label.
Undisputed Truth, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
And so he produced this, and
can I see the jacket?
Stands on its own.
Yeah. Have you...
This is 45?
45, yeah.
I just heard yesterday on WNYC a clip from the new Peter Gabriel sound. I think he's done the whole soundtrack for the new Edward Snowden movie. But
yeah, he has, yeah.
Man, the song that they played on the radio yesterday was so cool.
Oh, really?
I have huge respect for Peter Gabriel. I feel like when I heard that last time, I was like, I really got to go back and listen to Peter Gabriel's catalog. But beyond his catalog, he, kind of like David Byrne, who got Luwaka Bob, he opened up his own label that was part of this deal that was going on in the 80s, where like when you were a certain kind of artist,
you got your label.
In addition to getting, you know, signed and getting your advance and whatever positive terms you want, you got to keep your own label.
Right.
So what Peter Gabriel did was he opened up Real World, which is still functioning today and putting out super, super cool music. But I mean, he's the one that like widely broke Nusrat Fateh Ali Khan to the world. What's the name? There's this, I'm gonna blank on the name, but there's this like modern jazz group that one of the players plays this kind of UFO looking metal disc with fingertips. That's super, super cool. I wish I could remember the name of it, but that guy, Peter Gabriel, man, like serious guy.
I guess I had like a very neutral opinion on. I never really like tuned into his music, but sensed that he was a credible artist, but I was never drawn towards him.
That's a funny thing also about, I think, being somebody who's constantly searching for new music. I try to keep this in check, but when you're searching for new music all the time, I feel like you're less inclined to spend long periods of time with a single record or a single artist or on a particular genre for that matter. But I try, I've actually taken my DJ setup out of my house and I have it as a studio now. And one of the reasons why I did that is so that at home, of course I can like preview DJ records, but most of the time I'm listening to LPs at home.
Mm-hmm.
And I find that makes me engage with those records more. And when I really like a record, I will allow myself to just listen to it over and over and over again at the expense of learning more about other different kinds of music. And I feel like, for me, that's a really important thing. Like, and to do it with bands that are huge bands. Like, anytime a Radiohead record comes out, I buy the new Radiohead record and I listen to it over and over and over and over and over again because I want to have a relationship with it, because to me, that's important.
Right.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
And same thing happened with the last Kendrick Lamar record or the Alabama Shakes record that that won the Grammy last
right.
year. Like,
or like the D'Angelo record.
Right, yeah. It's just like these are, these are artists that are really popular.
When it comes to like more of the mainstream stuff that's going, I'm like, I'm just disconnected completely.
That's the point. Like, we can't, like, this is why I was asking the questions before. It's impossible for everybody to like do it all, right?
Yeah.
So you have to make choices around where you look and what you take in and what you leave behind, and that's really interesting to me.
Right. Yeah.
Like, You're making choices to like go deep on certain records and not on others.
Right, yeah.
Because you're making some sort of like conscious or unconscious trade-off about what's the best use of your energy.
Right, yeah. I try to remember one of the reasons why I allow myself to listen to like a Radiohead album over and over and over again is because that's what it was made for, right? I feel like those guys consciously, in particular Radiohead, they consciously make a decision to make an album that will unfold on
repeat
listening.
Did Tom York just like fold the band? I think he just retired. Yeah, he said that's it for Radiohead.
Really?
Yeah, I think I just heard something like last week.
Really?
A few days ago, yeah. I think Radiohead is...
You've just broken his heart.
So I think we have to wait for the reunion now.
I have a feeling that those
you'll check it out after.
Wouldn't,
I heard something about from some announcement that Tom York made.
Oh wow!
Yeah, about the future of Radiohead, but yeah, they're a really good live band too. Man.
I just saw them live.
You did? You went to the last?
Yeah.
I had some friends that went. I didn't make it.
Yeah, it was good. It was like I've seen them probably 15 times, and they were getting pretty crowdy. They were like kind of jamming out. I always want when I see them live because they're such a good band. I want them to just like let go and like just freak out for like 10
Fish
minutes at a time.
Grateful Dead, just take
I want
that
them
beat
to do the Radiohead, the Radiohead version of Fish, right? Or the Grateful Dead. Just like keep going and jam it out. And they were doing it as much as like proper Englishmen would. They're like, we're gonna really jam out now for 16 bars.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah.
But when they were doing it, it was...
No, the only way, you gotta drop some good acid and then...
Right.
And then
maybe
they
that's
really
their
go.
Problem, right?
I don't know. Problem. I don't know. Maybe it's the acid. Right. I don't know. But
I've got the next record that I'm going to play. Just when this one's done here, I'm going to pull it out. But I'll advance it a little bit by saying this is a record that I heard you play. It was the first time after years of going to Loft that I ever approached the DJ booth to ask what a record was.
Right.
And I'm not going to say what it was. Mm-hmm. I mean, you'll know it, and I think you probably spotted it here.
Yeah,
Eamon.
I've seen
it. But I want it to reveal itself.
I've heard you play it at the Loft as well, actually.
Oh, you've heard this continually played? Interesting.
I've heard Douglas play it. At the Loft.
Okay, I've only ever heard it played once. But the way it happened was on the dance floor, really, really in it, and I remember. I was kind of like amongst a few people who are kind of in a circle almost, really, really dancing hard. And I remember Tim Lee was among those people from Tummy Touch, who's mm-hmm. just like the
Tim
dude.
Lovely?
Yeah, Tim Lovely, right. Like just a don, like a guy with like unbelievable musical credibility.
Right.
And just like, I have big respect
got into
for this guy.
It. Got into it.
We were all just dancing so, so hard for it. And I was surprised what it was when I came over to the DJ booth.
Okay. Here, I'll let you...
Okay. Thanks. I can't remember if this is cut at 45 or 33.
Well, I got some headphones here, so I'll...
Yeah, that's a tricky... if it's one I think it is, I would guess 33.
Is it the first track?
It's the only track on that side, okay. I think. And you're best to find out if you look, like, listen there. It sounds like 33. Yep.
You know, one of the things in terms of my approach musically, I always lean towards the more psychedelic type stuff. And I think for me, the transformative, to get to a place where it becomes kind of transformative, that's where I've always kind of navigated more towards the psychedelic type of experience. Yeah. The more hard hitting kind of stuff, the EDM kind of stuff, tends to be a little colder and without the vocals, and you know, it gets tricky. But I'm always going through what I think is a type of distillation process musically. And you know, you go through things, you think that might work, or this sounds good, and then when you try it in a different setting, you realize, no, it didn't quite resonate the way I thought it might. And so it's a type of what I would describe as a process of distillation. And I've kind of gotten it down to where, for me personally, I think there's really only two types of music. And I think that's really what we're talking about here. And the two types of music for me really is music you like and music don't like.
Yeah, Duke Ellington said this as well.
And so everything else is just simply a way in terms of how you might find it in a library or categorize it for retail. But in terms of just being a lover of music, you know, I'm not into country music.
Right.
But my daughter is. And she always has the car, we have Sirius XM on in the car, and she'll have it tuned into the country stations. And every so often, there'll be that one record we'll kind of play, and I'll say, you know what, that actually is, that's a nice track. And I'll ask, who was that? And so, again, it comes back to, or a gospel record. I'm not necessarily into gospel music, but that doesn't mean that there isn't some wonderful music within that genre. So, in the end, it just becomes what you like and don't like.
Do those types of conversations or experiences, do they feel like they change or push the boundaries on the music that you do like? Do you find that yourself, you're evolving musically?
Like, do you find yourself saying, like, I do like country music, actually. I like all these artists.
Yeah, and there's actually this track that, I didn't bring it, but it's the last track I played for the last party, and it does have kind of a cowboyish, I wouldn't call it country, because it's this group, Buju, I'm screwing up the name on it. But anyhow, yeah, you know what, in the end, I think where it takes me is just to try to be more of an open conduit, or an open receptor to whatever could filter in.
Right.
You know, input and output.
Right,
So basically.
So we're going to hear country at the Loft, is that what you're saying?
If it gets us on the dance floor, you know, again, it's a process of distillation. And so if that filters down into that, you know, where it's something that could work, yeah, why not?
Right.
I remember you played Horse With No Name, and you wound up with Horse With No Name, and it was like the perfect record at that moment, man.
Yeah.
I'm like, man,
last year at
I wish I thought of that, and I love that record, man. But I never played it during a party.
Right.
You know, even one time listening to Francois Kevorkian play, and he worked in Jimi Hendrix, man, Machine Gun. And I'm
Man.
You could do that? You could do, and it worked.
Oh,
it
wow.
Like perfect record, you know, just the way he weaved it in, man, it worked.
We're getting now to the part of the song that, like, makes it more clear who it is and what it is.
I remember playing, and people like, Douglas is playing Dead Mouse?
Right.
Dead Mouse?
Well,
but it worked.
It absolutely worked. Like, that for me, that was like the pinnacle of that night. It was this, because the way the song starts is this super heady, psychedelic wash, right? And I remember everybody being on the dance floor and just like, totally vibing out to it, and then this part came in and everybody just like jumping up and down and going crazy for it.
That idea of the tapestry, another way of looking at it is, you know, you kind of building it up. You're kind of, you know, tightening it up, yeah. tightening it up, and then boom, you let it loose.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Right.
And then you kind of tighten it up again, and you let, and a movie is like that. A movie builds that tension,
yeah.
and then there's the revelation, and then it comes back to the, you know, yeah, and it's peaks and valleys.
Right,
peaks
yeah.
and valleys. So you're always kind of, you know, creating some tension, and then
letting it go.
And that's, well, I think, a record that does that well.
This fits in well with all the other things that we were talking about just now about, like, following what you actually like. And I also think that it speaks to a lack of pretension that you have about music that I really like, which is, like, you're not thinking, like, I'm going to play this Deadmau5 record because...
You're not playing it ironically.
You're not playing it ironically. Yeah, you're playing this you're playing this record because you like it and you believe in it. I admire that, and I aspire to that as well. I really, you know, it's funny. I actually played, after I heard this, I sought the record out, and I played it at a Mr. Sunday. Eamon wasn't there, and I played
probably
it.
A good thing.
it's a great record. It's
although I played Billy, I played Billy Idol a few weeks back, and Justin saw me queuing it up, and he was like,
which one?
He was,
it was great.
It was hot in the city because it was like 112 degrees and like 80% humid, as you know, because we've had a really difficult summer. And it was just perfect because people were just like cathartic.
Oh, it worked perfectly.
Which one?
Hot. It's called Hot in the City. It's like this arpeggiated thing, and then it breaks down into like an old school kind of like...
It wasn't Money Money.
Once in a
while. I think that's what you thought I was going to play.
I thought he was going to play Money Money. I was like, well, all
right. Right.
But
anyway, finish your Deadmau5 story.
When I played it at Mr. Sunday, it was at a moment when we were at the Gowanus where our disco ball was hanging really low over the dance floor.
Mm-hmm.
And there was this thing that people would do where they would want to touch the disco ball. And so people got so excited that they held onto the disco ball and they were jumping up and down and down, and then it came off of the thing, and then somebody...
Nobody got hurt, and now it's getting tossed around like a beach ball?
Yeah, somebody threw it up in the air like it was a beach ball and smacked some guy in the head.
Oh,
so bad. Oh, man. I haven't played the record again since then.
See? No, you gotta anchor that
EDM
beat.
EDM is dangerous.
Ball
we fixed our disco ball problem now. We've taken care of that. There's a little sign on the bottom of it that says, please don't touch the disco ball, it might fall down.
You know, I have a session I'm kind of beginning to build up now called Adventures in Flight. So I did a couple of launches of it at Good Room, and I'm in the Bad Room, which is a smaller room within the venue. And so I do a balloon drop, and the whole place is decked out in balloons. And I have a session coming up this Saturday, as a matter of fact.
Okay.
And so at a certain point, do the balloons, we drop them, and this is, you know, because it's it's not by invitation, it's more of it's a public venue, so you get a different kind of more unpredictable group of people, and they went crazy. And the next thing you know, with all the balloons bouncing around, now they're pulling down the ones that weren't part of the balloon drop, and they're yanking them, and this is the girls doing it, they're all kind of drunk, and they're yanking stuff down, and I had to literally come out from behind the turntables and say, hey guys, you gotta stop, you can't pull them all down. And at least they did. I had enough influence over it that they respected it and they stopped.
What's the concept of the new night? Like, is there
Adventures in Flight? I think I just try and spread wings into my wings in other areas that are not kind of more. There is always a certain expectation when people come to a party that they're going to hear a certain classics. So if you go to a garage reunion, you expect you're going to hear, and you're not going to hear this.
Right, right.
Okay. And what I want to do with Adventures in Flight is be a bit more experimental and try things out. Mm-hmm. The only trade-off with that is, depending on the venues that are allowing me to host these parties, you may get people that come up and right away they want to dictate, you know, because, hey, do you have so-and-so? Do you have Kanye West? Do you have this or that? And, you know, I'm like, you're along for the journey.
Yeah,
just
right.
Kinda, you know.
Well, this is a really interesting thing that we, Eamon and I talk about this all the time, because we have very particular ideas about what we want a party to be, what we want our party to be. But at the same time, we have a party that's open to the public, right? And of course, you open your doors to anyone who wants to come, which I think is largely a very good thing. And because of us doing that, the party has become something that, well, that couldn't be if it was a private party, right? Like, there are certain people that find out about the party. I remember when we were in Gowanus, people would just walk on the bridge that was next to the space, and they would find out about it. So we got a really interesting mix of people because of that. And, you know, when we're doing Mr. Sunday outdoors, music goes into the air, and I think a lot of people will just come and be like, what is this? And so you can bring in some really great different people, because you don't have a policy that says only this person.
You could kind of spread the message, so to speak.
Right, exactly. And I think there's something wonderful about that. Mm-hmm. But I mean, you talk about going out from behind the DJ
trade-off
and having to tell people like, hey, don't pull the balloons down off the wall.
Don't pull down the mirror ball.
Oh, don't pull down the mirror ball. Well, but right, exactly. So, you know, again, conflicted here. This is the theme of the day, you know, like
but you know what happens, my experience has been that you have enough people within that are familiar with what you're doing, that support what you're doing.
Yes.
And there'll be a bit of a counterweight to that.
They're the so counterweight.
They'll be on the floor and say, hey man, you
exactly. And they set a standard of behavior that other people have to adhere to, and other people notice, right? And I think that this is the most powerful way of like having a big party, but a special party at the same time. So we work hard to grow our membership group, which is a core of people that come to the party that get invited to be a member, very much like, you know, the Loft and Joy. And they only get invited if they behave in a certain way, they're seen to be behaving in a certain way. They're bringing
they're
energy.
Really into the party, right? Like you look and we're like, you are awesome.
They're contributing,
right? Yeah.
And so, if that's the core of the party, and people are seeing those individuals partying in that way, then they'll realize that's what the party is really about,
right?
And there'll be a sort of like a peer pressure to behave in the same way. But
sometimes it fails.
Sometimes
right?
it fails, yeah. And it requires constant work to maintain that. But I think there are, like, I think on this level specifically, when it comes to cell phone use on the dance floor, this is where Berghain and Panorama Bar have done it so well, because they don't have to police it, because the peer pressure that exists within the venue is so strong that people don't do it. I mean, you see it very occasionally, but like there's no security guards like stopping people do it. Just nobody does it because they know not to do it, because in their head, they'll be embarrassed if they do it.
Right. And it's connected with the identity of
the identity
that
is so
place.
Strong. Right.
Yeah, exactly.
So then that takes me back to the record you just played. So you have this intense moment, right? And then so what do you follow that with? Because that to me is what makes all of us kind of interesting and unique, is that we can all come to the party prepared to play records with the identical crate of records.
Right.
But it's not going to sound the same, because we're not going to play the records
order. How does that relate to the thing we were talking about before? Because you can change the mood and kind of like influence the way it feels.
Yeah, you can go this way, you can go that way.
Like if you see that the energy has gotten too intense, for example, or...
For example, like there was one time there was one party goer that was having a really hard time, and whatever her head was, so we put on a Marvin Gaye, "What's Going On?" And it was like, truly, the music calms the savage beast. I mean, not, you know, weren't necessarily being a savage beast, but it really, you know, just...
Well, the savage beast of the mind.
So, you know, with a record like that, the challenge is, so what do you follow that with, man?
Well, what are you going to follow with?
Ball, man. So, you know, we got to continue
I'm gonna
with this.
I'm going to follow with a Dutch new wave band playing a kind of like Indian track. And the reason I'm playing this is when I first came to New York, the parties that I were going to and the sort of DJs that I got to know initially were more playing rock and roll. And there was a party called Motherfucker that is a legendary New York party that was just full of, you know, rock and roll kids, but club kids and drag queens, and it had a big gay community. And it was a real, for somebody coming from, coming from Ireland and the UK, it definitely felt very New York and very, very unique and very different. And one of the DJs that DJed there was a girl called Justine D, who's got immaculate taste in music. And when the party got going, it was pretty much like rock and roll. It was kind of like a whole rockabilly thing, which was really cool. But when the party would start, she would play all sorts of just really weird, interesting music. And I picked this record up because I heard her play it at one of those parties. And it's just kind of...
It's going to be our palate cleanser for...
It's totally a palate cleanser from Dead Mouse. Let me just find the right part of the record here. Oh, wrong track.
Oh, that was really cool.
Good though.
It's all right. That is good, but this is the real track. Sorry, guys.
You gotta cleanse my palate from that one now.
Yes. I think they just put out like one record and then disappeared.
What year?
I think it's, I don't know, does it say that on the
list? Yeah, I can't see. Nope.
It's a New York label. But, I've looked
them
up
a little
bit. But
it's a Dutch band?
They're a Dutch band. And the rest of the stuff's just a little more sort of like new wave rock and roll. It's not really that remarkable. Maybe there's a couple of artists and tracks on, but this is the one I always go to.
World music.
Yeah.
It's really what it is.
What song is this?
It's Aka Rock.
Oh. Yeah. Also available on 8-track.
There you go.
For your 8-track collection.
Yeah.
Yeah, they took up a lot of room, those 8-tracks.
Did you have an 8-track?
Every car was equipped with 8-tracks. So when I was a kid, for a penny, you can order like 100 records. You get the first 10 free, and then they start billing
like the Columbia House thing?
Yeah, Columbia House thing. And so...
That was CDs when I was a kid.
We would get 8-tracks for the car, and they would be like in console of the car, but you could only fit like maybe 5 of them because they're like big cartridges that take up a lot of room.
How much... Could you fit a whole album on an 8-track, or would you have to have multiple?
Yeah, they had the whole album. Okay. And you know what? The quality of the 8-track was better than a cassette.
Huh.
You didn't have as much of a hiss.
Oh, right, because it was 8-track tape.
Yeah, yeah. So it actually had a better sounding quality than
a wider tape
than a cassette.
Huh.
Yeah. But it
just
wasn't practical. We
gotta wait for the new 8-track labels cropping up.
Let's do it.
Me and you doing it.
Let's do it. Let's all do it.
Okay, well, you can be...
Because he knows a lot more about it than we do.
Right. Yeah. You can at least consult for us, Doug.
So, where do we go with the conversation at this point? It's been interesting.
I think we're winding up.
Let me ask you, how do you... One thing I would say about having listened to the two of you play together is that there is a certain degree of like seamlessness between the two of you. When you're really like in your element, it's like almost, it's just body language at some point, which is really nice to see. I happen to see that also with Joey Janos and David DePino when they did the birthday tribute to Larry Levan at Output. They were doing their thing, and it was really kind of a seamless So I saw a little bit of a similarity there, from what I also have seen with you guys.
That's very nice.
Thank you very much.
Yeah.
But not to say that you don't each have your own signature or your own kind of line, because I always think of, you know, every artist has their own kind of line. Like right. You look at a Keith Haring, you know right away, or you know, Mondrian, you know right away.
Well, there's a line. The good artists do, right? Yeah. Like the good artists, you can look at their art and you can be like, that is a piece by that artist, right?
Yeah. You just kind of know.
I mean, we've been playing together now for at least 10 years,
mm-hmm.
right? And so there's just, you hope at this point that we can work together somehow, right. You know?
You learn the other person's style, right?
Right.
So when we're playing back to back, you can anticipate what they're going to play and the direction they're going to go. And I think one of the things that I like about it is we go in more directions because there's two minds thinking about the same circumstances.
Mm-hmm.
So, or if I'm playing on my own, I may be on a certain track and I'm, you know, trying to think of like different options and be open-minded so that you can take the party in different directions. When there's somebody else thinking about it, like they're going to come up with options that you don't. And that's, mm-hmm. that's really interesting. Mm-hmm. It can be challenging, but it's interesting. And I think when we're at our best, we're both doing that for each other. And then, mm-hmm. You're playing off each other and responding to each other. Mm-hmm. So it's almost like, you know, two heads are better than one.
We've done at Joy when I'm playing with Takaya and Yuji, the three of us, since, you know, we do like every other party, you know, in rotation. But for the anniversary and for the Halloween party coming up, we all play together. And so one thing, and this actually comes out of my experience with David, is we would do one and one. So
right.
One, and we just go around that way. And what that kind of does is it challenges you to kind of collectively think of the party and really shed the ego. Because when you're, if I said, do a set, and you're going to say, okay, good, I'm going to pick three or four or five records and, you know, and shine, as opposed to just put one record on and think of the party and you do the next one.
Right,
and
yeah.
And when you do that kind of a sequence, it really does. And so there have been a few times where we didn't even say we were going to do that. It just kind of what we did, and it just worked really nice.
Right.
Yeah.
And so you couldn't tell. And that ultimately for me is what I try to get to, is where I really want to just become invisible, and it's the music that everybody just responds to.
Yeah.
Well, I think that's a pretty nice sentiment to end on. Do you want to give us one more record?
One last record.
We'll play it out.
Outro.
Okay, let's see.
It's funny to think about that whole idea of like feeling sensitive about being on the spot and wanting to be invisible. I actually feel like uncomfortable when it feels like people are like watching us DJ,
mm-hmm.
like standing at the front and staring at just, because I feel like
that's not what
I feel like I'm supposed to be doing something when somebody's watching it.
Always, right.
Like, yeah.
Well, you know what? That's probably for a whole other conversation.
Right. Yeah.
This, I think, is always a nice choice of a record.
Let me see that. I've heard this for sure.
But you don't know this?
Oh.
No. Yeah, you know Sun Palace and both sides. It's just variation.
I've heard this before. No, tell us about this.
So this record, I think, came out sometime around 80s, somewhere in the 80s. Anyhow, it was just one of these releases from the UK, and David, so we had Vinyl Mania was like one of the main sources to buy records. On Carmine Street. Yeah. And Charlie had gotten in this record. And,
of course.
And when we heard it, we were like, wow. And that was just one of those records. And I remember David went out and got like 25 copies and gifted some of his friends with that record.
Oh, wow.
Like, he just wanted to share it. So
Beautiful. And now that it's playing,
and it just another kind totally of a, became, it. I guess, a bit of a signature record for us.
Yeah.
But you know, it's all that energy. It's just where it goes. You know.
That's nice. I've never heard this. This is really good.
I think they did a repress of it. I saw it at Downtown 304. Had a repress of it. Yeah, this is always
really nice. This is a taken home record.
Yeah. Oh yeah. Outstanding and going, kind of flowing.
Do you find
that
those records can also be your opening records? They're almost
interchangeable. We've done that where we reversed it. We say, you know what, records that we kind of wind down with. Let's see if we can wind up with them.
Right.
You know, let's flip it around the other way.
You say we've done this. So does that mean that like there are designated crates? Like these are the.
Well, the way it used to be when we were really home, it was really a fixed library. And so you had your go-to records, and there were some new things that would end up in this bin. And then you had records down here that were just part of the library. And so every so often you were kind of always purging or rotating through records. And so, you know what, I think this one is kind of needs break for a while, and that will come out, and something else will kind of come out and go in. So you always had this kind of rotation going on with the library, and and it flowed in a certain kind of order. So from the beginning to the, and so you could start from the back forward.
I see. Come back
because you were because you were following the record.
Reverse.
Like you would play a record, and then you would put it down, and so therefore you would always have.
Well,
the
library
last party would.
If you just followed the order that the that bin was set in, you could just, that would be the party.
Right.
But you didn't necessarily want to do that. So you had other bins that also had, you were always kind of bouncing back and forth. But that first one was kind of like, that was your signature set of music was always right there.
Right, okay. Right.
But that's in a fixed setting. When you're kind of setting up and breaking down, you kind of approach it a little differently.
Right. So. Well, I mean, I do that when I, particularly for our parties, depending on what section I'm playing, but I have like a bin of opening records. But that's why I asked the question. I find myself, as I've been warming up, I'm playing records. I've been like, that will work. If we get the party to that point, that'll work on the way down as well.
Right, yeah.
And if you can get to the point where it does work, you know you've had a good party.
You know what I really like, though, is to figure out a way to get those early records to work at the peak time, right? When I'm playing a record early and I'm like, wait a second, like this.
Well, I'm kind of talking about peak time, but I'm talking about you've got the peak time
when it's like open.
You've got them,
in
the palm of your hand. You can see everybody's moving together cohesively, and you can play that record and they'll go with it.
Right.
Do you mark your records at all? Like aside from 33 or 45, is there any other kind of indication?
At some point I used to, but I feel, at one point, I was marking my records with BPM,
right?
But I stopped doing it because I felt like it would lead me too much.
Yeah,
you know.
Yeah.
I don't know.
But it's kind of good to know the pace of a record.
But there are some records that are super high energy that are low tempo.
That's right. Yeah, you know? Joe Clasell's records,
right,
are a good example of that. Yeah.
I saw this one was marked. Did you do that?
Yeah, all my records. I only do that for the pacing. Because, like you said, it doesn't dictate that it should fall here or there, but after a while, I don't remember all the, I guess I'm getting old now.
Well, also,
so I don't remember the pacing, and there have been times where I put on a record that I said, yeah, I think, and it goes a little more high energy than I meant, and I'm like, I forgot it was that fast, okay. Right. So it just helps me with pacing.
Because you don't cue with headphones.
No.
So this is another thing, like, I don't need to do that because I can put my headphones on and like be like, this doesn't really make sense right now, and take it off. Right?
Well, because we have
really
an audiophile approach,
there's
no headphone jack in high-end stuff.
Wow.
You don't have a head. You need a separate component that will go into, you know, your outputs for.
So you
for
really have to
headphones.
Know your records better than most of the DJs.
You just have to know your music. You just have, not better than anyone, but you just have to be confident with.
Right.
Yeah. But you know what? It's funny because I made up a list of like. Everything a DJ should have, like I'm kind of conceptualizing a book, and part of it is like, what are all the tools? What should be in your tool bag? to really calibrate and be prepared on every level, everything down to Tums, right? Because you might eat something before and you say, oh man, I got reflux, man. I need Tums. Or you split a nail, oh man, you have a nail clipper? Because that can drive you crazy. You know. So I made up the list and somebody said to me, I know there's one thing you don't have on that list. And I have about maybe 65 things. And I said, no, I'm complete, man. And they said, headphones.
You didn't have headphones on the list?
That's hilarious. It never occurred to me. I said, yeah, you're right. Yeah. Don't have headphones. Never use them.
But you don't need them.
Well, I mean, I've used them, but, you know, I'm more comfortable. The way we approach the music, it's
they're not
the
needed.
Record begins and the record ends.
Right.
It's
right.
just
yeah.
never
but
really.
But it also takes away no that cue. Like that safety blanket of being able to cue something up and decide not to play it.
Right.
Then you have to know, like Justin said, you have to know your records.
Well, I have queued up records, and I'm saying at the last minute, like, nah, let me check, and I'm like. Takaya, grab that, take that off, and because I have like seconds, and
right?
I'm
making
a last minute change like that, but it's just what's in the head, and not there's no headphones.
I think it's ultimately a good thing.